Hi, I'm Lee McMahon. I'm a sound engineer working in both live and studio. I've been most recently working with Pale Waves, but over the last sort of 2-3 years, I've worked with bands like The National, Michael Kiwanuka, Love Film Tragedy, and I've also just finished doing the Lush classical orchestra gig. I started getting into live sound when I graduated from uni in 2012. Previous to that, I was a drummer, and that's all I ever wanted to do. I had no idea of doing anything audio related as a career. It was around like 2007 when I decided to sort of step back from playing and learn how to record, and that's kind of where this all started. So for years, from maybe 2007 to 2011, all I wanted to do was be a recording engineer. And it was in 2011 I actually decided to finally try and like pursue this end of the sort of the industry. And then I moved back to Belfast in 2012 and I started working at Star Together with Rocky. And it was at that time when I met and saw Watch From Afar, and they asked me to come out on tour and mix them for a tour because I had done 2 records with them. Literally the rest is history. I have basically since 2012, 2013, it's all I've done is just tour. And still do some bits and pieces of studio production and stuff like that, but I've primarily just been touring since 2012. My influences for the job that I do currently, which is primarily a front of house engineer, there are multiple. There are lots local, there are lots national, and there are lots that I've never met. But there, you know, there are people like, you know, that I aspire, you know, to have their skill set still to this day. You know, people like Mark Harlan, who makes Muse, Toby Francis, Andy Mayer. These are all top list, sort of A-list engineers. Studio-wise, one of my biggest influences is Rocky, because Rocky was the reason why I moved back to Belfast and met these people, and he gave me the chance to try things, and you know, he gave me a shot straight out of university as somebody that had a piece of paper that said I could be an audio engineer, but you know, that's a piece of paper. You know, you need to figure those skills out. So I have a lot to thank him for in terms of giving me the chance to try new things and meet new people, which have ended up leading me to where I am today. So yeah. The one that still sticks in my mind the most was whenever I was in India with So I Watch You back in like 2014. We were playing this festival in Bangalore, and you know, we like loaded in the morning, and it was a beautiful day, and you know, we went back to the hotel and slept, and we all woke up, and you know, there was just this crazy storm. So we went to the festival site and it was just chaos. There was like wind blowing tents over, and like they closed down half the site, and like half the people had left and everything. And yeah, it was crazy, just because we were in a situation where like people were on stage getting like electrocuted and playing in puddles, and guitar amps were exploding, and like, you know, as Spinal Tap as it sounds, like it was, you know, pretty funny. But we you know, they played through that, you know, because the fans were there, you know, like soaked to the skin, you know. And you know, a band like It's All Watch You obviously have a fan base, you know, the fan base is all over the world, and they don't like to disappoint. So they, you know, they played the show regardless of what was going on around them. And, you know, there was like water in the mixing console, and Niall, the guitarist, got like 2 or 3 really bad electric shocks. And then on the same trip, we did a show in Delhi with Meshuggah. And that was one of those cool moments, because they're like, you know, like a lot of things with touring with bands and stuff like that, you get to go to places you'd never think you'd ever go to, and you'd get to experience things you'd never think you'd get to experience. So getting to see a band like that in a really foreign environment, you know, was just really cool and really memorable. And yeah, same thing. Again, we did some shows in Morocco with Nsawachu. We did a show in this kind of like outdoor park in right in the city center of Marrakesh. And it was like 40 something degrees. It was like one of the hottest things I'd ever experienced. Like, I'm obviously not quite, you know, used to hot weather. And yeah, like drum heads were melting because it was so warm. You know, the PA system was like two or three different PA systems, like ratchet strapped together. I mean, we just made it work. It was fun. And it was just really cool just watching like kids like listen to like Northern Irish post rock in, you know, a very odd setting, and they were like loving it. You know, it was really, really, really cool. And then also, like, you know, so those are like sort of very specific examples, but there's so many other, you know, examples of like really memorable experiences, but kind of too many to mention. But the thing for me really is just anytime you're really up against it, like either it's like something like a big London show or whatever, where everyone's like super stressed and, you know, there's management there and there's people, family, whatever, you know, you just want to, everyone wants to do the best they physically can. The band wants to play physically the best they can, and you know, anyone that's working on the show wants to do the best thing that they can. And it's just really, it's always a really nice feeling when you get to sort of get to the end of the show and everything's gone really well and everyone's had a really good time. Those are the moments where you really kind of relish your job, and it makes up for the, you know, days and hours and weeks and months that you spend on buses and airports and crap hotels and all that kind of stuff. You know, I say that, you know, I absolutely love my job. You know, it's all part of it. You know, I can't really imagine doing anything else now. Vinnie Cagliuta, Keith Carlock, Stuart Copeland, John Theodore. They're my four favorites at the minute. The top three have never really changed. But at the minute, I'm really liking John Theodore. He's playing in this band called Mini Mansions right now, who are awesome. I saw them at Reading and Leeds this year. Favorite drummers I've worked with myself through various different roles. I think the one that really does actually stick out for me is Brian Devendorf from The National. Because his whole thing is about treating a drum kit to sound a certain way for their live shows. And I think that's really cool because he takes that influence from what he would do in the studio and he does it live. So he's putting things like, you know, goat toe things on hi-hats and, you know, sheets on cymbals. And he swaps cymbals out during the show and everything like that, swaps snare drums out. Lewis, his drum tech, earns his paycheck because they swap stuff throughout the show. And he flies his CNC drum kit everywhere. It doesn't matter where they're playing. It goes on the plane because he has a way of doing things, and I totally understand that because his drum sounds are so ubiquitous and he can't get those with rental kits, so I totally get that. Kira, who plays for Pale Waves, I really love working with Kira because it's a collaborative effort when it comes to like the drum sound for Pale Waves live, because if you listen to the record, it's mostly, there's live drums in there, but it's very sample based in terms of like a bit of a throwback to like 80s drum machine kind of thing. So what we try and do collaboratively is figure out a way of trying to get a drum kit to sound live like it's being played by a human, but with the same kind of consistency and fidelity of like drum samples. So we use a load of different things. We use, you know, we trigger things, we trigger gates, we trigger, you know, non-linear reverb things to just make the drums sound really, really interesting and but still human. And her new kit, she's just become a DW endorsee recently, and her new kit sounds amazing. So that's been really easy to do. I think the key to that is to not be afraid to try new things. But you know, obviously you still want to be comfortable, you know, with your, whether it's your stick size or the size of the drums you play or whatever like that. But I think the thing that I encounter the most when it comes to drummers bringing their drums into a live environment is, and it all boils down to tuning, and I feel like it's a bit of a lost art now, and there are so many like gadgets and whiz bangs you can get now to like really help. The TuneBot is an amazing amazing piece of kit, and it's not that expensive, and I would say that any touring drummer should own one, because all it does for me is, it's like, once you figure out when you get a drum to sound the way you want it to, or your front of house engineer does, you clip it on and you save that. You hit it, you save it, you got a value in there, and you can always go back to that, or especially just get close to it, you know, it makes a big difference. But, you know, as a front of house engineer, I would love if I could mic up a drum kit and not have to gate everything and pull tom resonances out of every individual channel, and I would love to use the overheads, but if the drummer's playing all cymbals and barely playing the drums in a small venue, they're pointless. So it's just that sort of thing where it's like, you just end up like having to reverse engineer the whole thing so much so, and then you end up just basically using the kick drum mic and the snare drum mic and nothing else is in the PA, you know, and I think that's a shame, even in a small room. So I would say, like, treating your drum kit and like paying attention to it and making sure that, you know, there's no weird rattles, there's no weird, like, you know, even things like making sure that this doesn't rattle, you know, and, you know, having fairly recently, you know, new heads on things and just making sure that there's actually some tone in the drums. And yeah, and just taking a bit of time to learn how to tune, because that just helps leaps and bounds. The drum kit in a live situation and a studio situation, they kind of form pretty much the same core purpose. It is kind of the bedrock of the song. It's your center of timing, it's your center of everything. But I feel like, you know, in a live domain, you're kind of, it's a compromise between what comes off the stage and what you can put through a PA system and all that kind of stuff. It depends on the size of the venue and whatever. The drum kit has, in terms of all the instrumentation in a band, apart from like maybe like synths and stuff like that, it has the biggest bandwidth. But it's pretty much the only transient instrument as well. So, you know, in terms of like headroom of like how a PA system works or how speakers work, you're getting a transient through those things. So like, and the, you know, the kick drum is the formation of your low end in a mix, as well as your bass guitar. But you know, if you look at like club music in a big club with a big club PA system, it's about low end, and you know, people want to feel that low end. And then the snare drum is part of that as well. And then the hi-hat is the furthest part of that spectrum. And then everything else kind of fills that thing. So you are going from, you know, from the bottom to the top in one instrument. And that's critical to most Western music, regardless of what genre it is. It could be metal, it could be pop, it could be anything. Especially now with drummers now starting to use more like hybrid setups and electronic things as well, then you further extend that range, because there's, you know, you could trigger a sample in your kick drum which extends a further octave down than your real bass drum ever could. Or it's the same with your snare drum. It's like, it could trigger a sample that's like a white noise thing that's way up high that your physical drum could never do. So you're just kind of, yeah, you're making it more hi-fi, I guess. And you know, as PA systems get better and you know, drum kit technology in terms of like triggers and modules and brains and SPDS, all that kind of stuff, like get better and more accessible, especially from a price point, I see more and more people experimenting now with that kind of thing. But in essence, it's, I mean, I'm biased because I'm a drummer, but it is the most important instrument for me. It's like, if the vocal is the key thing that you want to hear at a live show, I don't care what anyone says. It's like, most people, if you buy a ticket to go and see a band live, if they can't hear the intelligibility of the vocal, then the gig's kind of ruined for them. But I feel like you owe it to pair that with the rhythm and sort of within that, then there's a spectrum. So it everything has a space. You can create a space for everything, but it's a very critical part of a live show. So in terms of stuff coming up, I've got Shox, who are a three-piece band from Bangor, in the studio in the next couple of days. We're doing their first single, which will be really cool. I haven't done anything with a band from Northern Ireland for ages, so I'm really excited to get sort of back into studio and create some crazy sounds. In terms of touring, I have some touring for the rest of the year. I'm going back out with the National for a couple of months, looking after one of their engineers as a tech. And then I've got a quick trip to Thailand to do one show with Pale Waves, as you do. Apart from that, this year I'm spending sort of the rest of this year sort of putting the final finishing touches on this sort of this new venture that I'm starting, which is basically trying to encapsulate everything I do as an engineer, both live studio production wise, live production, and in a hope to work with a lot more sort of like-minded people from both here in Belfast and further afield. But I can't talk too much about it yet, so I will update you accordingly when it comes out. But yeah, as silly as it sounds, I'm actually just really enjoying being home and being able to do like normal things, like put up shelves and move house again and all that kind of stuff, because I've spent the last like 18 months not here, and it's been really fun and I've had some amazing experiences, but it's just been nice to just kind of recharge my batteries a little bit. And yeah, and being able to utilize this space and actually like record drums and play drums, because that's the essence of this whole thing is about drums. I never get to play drums anymore, and it goes all the way back to the first question, but you know, wherever I can now, I will try to actually play, because I miss it. And